So Tor is an amazing person. He's one of the neuroscience superstars. He's the director of the Cognitive and Affective Neuroscience Laboratory. He's a professor at the Department of Psychology and Neuroscience at the University of Colorado. He's one of the top pain neuroscientists in the world, and I think he made a really big splash in 2013 with an article in the New England Journal of Medicine, which basically demonstrated an fMRI-based approach to quantifying pain using machine learning approaches, those approaches I just mentioned. He's appointed to the Presidential Task Force for the International Association for the Study of Pain, where he chairs the Working Group for Brain Imaging Technologies. There's no one on earth more qualified to give us an update on the current state of pain, current state of the art of pain neuroimaging.
Thank you. That was a very generous introduction, and what a terrific setup for the talk. Yeah, great to be here. I see my role here as providing some food for thought in terms of setting up a discussion of how to use these things in law. Some of this overlaps. I know Sotavi set up this idea of the opioid crisis beautifully, and some of what I'll present overlaps with what I presented a couple weeks ago at the National Academy of Sciences, where there was a meeting all about the opioid crisis and what we do about it. So you see this is a little bit clinically focused in some parts, but I'll come back to the end about what I think this means for law. So pain and suffering are the primary reasons people seek medical attention, and both of them cut across fields in medicine and even have causes and antecedents that are not medical at all, but related to stressors, traumas, and things that happen in our daily lives. And in spite of their importance, current pain measurement technology, as Tavi said, is this cup, which this is the cup that was given to my wife during the birth of our third child. So it's got pain faces, 1 to 10 scale, and pain in 8 languages or something. And the issue, and of course we need to use those scales and we need to trust them because that is the best way that somebody can tell us how they feel. The problem though is that what goes into that level 7 rating on the pain scale is actually quite complicated. There are prior beliefs, there's nociceptive input, which creates the experience of pain, there are emotions, there's a reporting context. People report pain to another person in a particular setting, in a particular culture. And all of those things influence decisions about what people report. And so there are different implications of those different kinds of decisions. So just as one example, we've done a series of experiments in my lab where we use heat pain, like this is a thermode that goes on people's arms, 48 degrees. And what we tell people is other people rated this particular stimulus as fairly low. And we indicate that to them in a very simple way, and people's pain ratings are here. And then we give the exact same stimulus, but we tell them other people thought this was high, and people rated it as substantially higher. We've tested this now in about 200 people. 94% of people in this sample show that effect. It's an incredibly strong effect. That doesn't mean that those influences on pain reports are all biased or all meaningless. Our job is to understand them. But some of it certainly is biased. And this is an internet meme, but I like it because what this shows you is about 150 different kinds of cognitive biases that go into people's decision making and behavior. I won't go through each one of these here for you today. Obviously. but I'm going to talk about the pain neurophysiology and what this can help, how this might be able to help. So pain neurophysiology is also complex, of course. There are 5 major ascending pathways that you see here in blue. They target brain activities at multiple levels of the neuroaxis. Every one of those targets is also contacted by descending projections from areas like the ventromedial prefrontal cortex and others. And so one way of thinking about this is what emerges is a mix of what ascends from the bottom-up input and what's coming from the top-down. And there is potentially no area in the brain or no circuit that represents the quote-unquote true pain value or true nociceptive input to the brain independent of the effects of context and expectation and belief and other kinds of processes. There's a rich pharmacology. These neurochemicals here just scratch the surface. But in spite of all of this complex pharmacology that we understand a little bit about, in spite of all the studies that have been done, thousands of studies now, a year on pain and the brain, we really don't know which of these neurochemicals or which of these circuits is necessary and sufficient for creating pain in any given situation. So in short, we really still don't know where the pain is. One thing that's relevant for patients and for the law is this phenomenon of central sensitization, whereby post-injury neurons in the periphery, in the spinal cord, and in the brain itself have been sensitized to input. So something that was previously non-painful, light touch, becomes painful because of enhancements in some cases, spinal nociceptive circuits. So more information is being conveyed to the brain. So this is a feature of many pain conditions, fibromyalgia, arthritis, musculoskeletal disorders, headache and migraine, and others. And so it's really one kind of principle that helps us understand that yes, there really can be something happening that's not in the periphery that's really important in the central nervous system for understanding pain. And incidentally, in some models, this kind of sensitization can cause pain to spread from body site to body site. So how can you have a knee injury where your knee hurts for a while and then the pain spreads to the other knee or spreads to other parts of your body? How can that be real? I think people can't get their heads wrapped around that. But indeed, there are neuroscience models that show that this can really happen. And so the pain can be real, even if it's spreading from body site to body site in a way that we don't understand. So neuroimaging can help to address these problems in certain ways. There are two main imaging modalities. There's positron emission tomography, which involves the injection of a radioactive tracer into the bloodstream. And it's good for imaging particular molecular compounds, like opioid receptors and dopamine receptors, and about 150 other kinds of neurochemical mediators. Then fMRI is what I'll spend most of my time talking about. And it's got complementary strengths. So this is the same kind of machine that you would see in virtually now any hospital in the US. Most are geared towards structural MRI or anatomical pictures of the brain, but we can also take functional pictures of the brain with different software on the same scanner. And this now gives us a snapshot of local regional brain activity about every half a second at this point now, speeding up. So every half a second we can get about 300,000 bits of information about functional activity. And through understanding those dynamic processes and how they unfold as people experience thoughts, feelings, pain, other kinds of emotional events, then we hope to be able to understand how the brain creates those phenomena. And the nice thing about MRI is that in this complex brain-body circuit, you can put something in the scanner for an hour and a half and collect multiple different kinds of images that are relevant in different ways. So you can collect data that's related to brain structure, or the tractography in the brain, white matter tracts, or the vasculature, simply through different tuning, software tuning parameters, essentially. And we can look at functional activity in regional brain activity. This is a map from Jack Gallant's lab that Tavi showed before, brain connectivity and relationships with physiology, for example. So what we'd like to do using imaging is develop biomarkers for pain. So a biomarker is an objectively measured process that indicates a mental experience or process. And it could be anything. It could be in the blood or in the skin. But here we'll use patterns of brain activity as potential biomarkers. So if I deliver a painful event, I would like to observe a characteristic pattern that's linked to the subjective experience of pain or whatever other outcome I'm measuring as strongly as possible. And one change in how we started thinking about brain imaging data is as follows. At a minimum, a biomarker should be sensitive and specific for the outcome that it's intended to measure. And previously, people did a lot of work looking at what Tavi called the forward inference and looking at what lights up or what activates in different parts of the brain when you're doing a number of different things, but without really ever trying to formally test the sensitivity and specificity of those brain images or particular outcomes. And that's what you need to do for reverse inference. And that's what has been a real revolution in how we've started thinking about our brain data and how many others in the field have as well. So a biomarker really isn't isn't exactly what you want. What you really would like to know is, well, how is pain represented in the brain? But representation is an abstract concept. It would be a circuit whereby if I activate the circuit, then I always get pain. And if I can suppress activating the circuit, I always eliminate pain. Right? So it's a causal generative mechanism for pain. We can't get that. We're measuring correlations. But I like to say that brain biomarkers that are sensitive and specific are gateways to understanding the representation. So think of a biomarker, having a biomarker as a necessary condition for understanding the representation. If you don't have that, you don't know what you're actually measuring. A few important notes. We can use these biomarkers to augment pain reports, to confirm pain in particular, but not to replace pain reports. For many reasons, but in part because everybody's brain might be different. So somebody might experience real pain for in different neurological reasons. Their brain might have reorganized in some strange way. And so it's a very dangerous game to try to disconfirm pain using any kind of biomarker. So I believe in augmentation. We can use them to understand the mechanisms underlying pain, to define brain targets for interventions and other kinds of processes. We can define biotypes, different types of individuals who exhibit pain for different neurological reasons or with different neurological correlates. And the way we're going is using these brain measures not to measure capital P pain, but to measure components of pain, where different systems contribute different things to an overall patient's experience. A little bit more about why brain biomarkers in particular. And most of the pain research field is focused on the periphery. Probably about 90% of the field works in the periphery or in the spinal cord and doesn't consider the brain. But there is a growing number of studies that do things like this, a nerve injury model in an animal where it's a partial nerve injury, which creates persistent pain behavior, inflammation, and neuroplasticity in multiple circuits in the brain. And here's a quick snapshot of where many of those circuits are. So there's the spinal cord, a big one. There's a Ross Revention medulla, pain control circuit, amygdala, the thalamus, the somatosensory cortex, the prefrontal cortex, the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. Here, this meaning-related circuit or motivation-related circuit, nucleus accumbens, and really a few others that aren't even shown here. And in all of these areas, there's neuroplastic changes after an injury that are linked to chronic pain and that seem to maintain chronic pain. In multiple cases here, you can intervene in an animal in those brain areas and reverse the long-term pain behavior. So these circuits are really important. But I think one of the things we need to understand is which of these mechanisms from animal studies are relevant in humans. So those animal pain models are relevant for a subset of cases in humans, and we're not sure when they apply and when they really don't apply. So that's one question. We need human brain studies to translate between neuropathology in animal models in these circuits and neuropathology in human models. And second question, what's the locus of pathology in a given human patient? So there are many candidates, as I've just shown you, and a given person might have neuropathology in any one or multiple regions in the brain. So that's really essential, I think, for matching treatments to the disease mechanisms themselves. If we can understand the type of pathology a person has, then we can understand how our treatments work in relation to that pathology. So here are multiple brain targets, as I said. And the basic gist of where we're headed is that we think we've identified a circuit that's related to nociceptive pain, what's coming in from the body in many cases, which is a spinal thalamocortical circuit. But there are other pathways that are related to fear and avoidance surrounding pain, which aren't about the nociceptive drive or pain-inducing drive in the first place, but about how the organism responds to that pain. So a parabrachial amygdala pathway, another pathway related to motivation is the medial prefrontal accumbens pathway. And this is also becoming quite important in the animal neuroscience on pain models. So the vast majority of pain drugs, we think we understand the drugs pretty well because we've studied their peripheral mechanisms and their mechanisms at the receptor level quite extensively. So opioids, we know a lot about what opioids do to receptors. But opioids are distributed throughout all of these brain areas. We know next to nothing about what opioids do to circuits involved in motivation or fear and avoidance and et cetera, in the prefrontal circuits for control. So here are some use cases for neuroimaging for clinical trialists and for people doing treatment design. And notice I've left the legal applications off until the end, so we can think about that together. We can use brain markers for several purposes. One, to demonstrate drug penetrance. We often don't know from animal studies whether a drug even gets into the brain because every species is different. So many drugs that work really well in rodents just don't even get into the human brain. We can use them for pharmacodynamics, which is to establish a dose of a treatment or intervention that has a clinical effect or it has an effect on the brain circuits that we think are causing pain or helping ameliorate pain. We can use them to evaluate efficacy in a preliminary way, and we can use them to understand mechanism. All of those things are important as well from a drug regulatory perspective, if you want FDA approval for a drug. For patients and for clinicians, we can do several things. We can help explain. Many people really want to know desperately, what's wrong with me? Why can nobody figure this out? And when it's above the neck, it becomes very hard using current technology to understand that. And there's really no place in current modern pain medicine for understanding contributions to pain that are above the neck. We can use it to understand risk. Who is at risk for developing chronic pain based on brain phenotypes, for example? We can invent prevention, and we can use it to target interventions to patients, ideally. So I'll talk a little bit about some of the work that's been done in these areas, just in very brief. So I'll talk about penetrance and pharmacodynamics, and I'll highlight a paper that was published recently, a couple of years ago now, in Science Translational Medicine by Eugene Duff and Irene Tracy and colleagues. And in this study, what they did is they looked at 8 different studies of 6 different drugs they had collected, often in collection and conjunction with pharma companies. So they have brain maps associated with each of these different drug effects, and then there's some placebo maps here. And what they did is use a simple version of a machine learning algorithm that Tavi had mentioned to ask, well, can we detect what's different in the brain? Can we find a reliable difference between drug and placebo? So that tells us that something's getting into the brain, and we have a brain pattern that's associated with that drug delivery versus placebo. And so this is the map that they showed for that. What exactly it means here isn't super important for us right now, but yellow is more activity with the drug, blue is less activity with the drug. I'll just point out that these circuits that are activated with the drug, this is, for example, the parahippocampal cortex. This is not a pain area in the brain. So one of the major areas that's showing the most reliable drug differences is an area of the brain that's associated with memory and processing of context and meaning, putting the self in context. So we have a lot more to learn. So they have a pretty good hit rate for known drugs here. It depends, 56 to 92. And the use case is, they say, you know what, if you did this in an early phase clinical trial where you have only a few people, maybe you have 20 to 40 or 50 people in your trial, and so you can afford to put this through imaging and process this, then you can make an early decision, a stop-go decision. And if you don't see evidence for pharmacodynamic effects in the brain, you better stop, cut that off, because it's not gonna work when you take it to a big phase 3 clinical trial. So they make pretty good stop-go decisions in this set of studies. So this is really a proof of concept. Another really interesting part of this paper is the idea that you can use these brain data ultimately for drug discovery and drug repurposing. And again, this is really just a proof of concept at this point. But the idea is, you can look at the relationship and how similar are the brain maps when you're getting gabapentin versus pregabalin versus remifentanil versus cannabinoids, which look quite different. So this is a map of the similarity in the brain maps. So what are the overall drug effects, right? And then you can see that, for example, like I said, the THC looks quite different. Some of these things look pretty similar to one another. So if you have a drug that's purposed for one and approved for one purpose, and you say, here's a new compound, this looks pretty similar to that in terms of the brain areas it's affecting, maybe that can help you repurpose that drug for a new setting, for a new use. Okay, so I'm going to turn now to some of the work that we've done to develop and push forward the idea of developing biomarkers for evoked pain. Something that we can control, something that's a feature of central sensitization and of multiple clinical disorders, but is not a clinical disorder or clinical pain in itself. And the idea, and I'll give you the simple cartoon version, and not the complex machine learning version, because I think the concept is what really matters. So the idea is that we take a training sample of individuals, and everybody gets painful stimuli of multiple intensities. We start with heat pain, and we start testing in other kinds of pain as well, mechanical, electrical, laser, pressure. And here, they're getting four levels of pain for each person, and we collect the pain reports. So this is the data that we're trying to understand with the brain. And then we take the brain images, and we put it into a simple version of a machine learning algorithm that's really designed to be highly interpretable. Because we want to know, unlike some of the deep neural network stuff, where it's really hard to understand what your network is actually really doing, we want a simple map where we can interpret that in the context of what we know about the neuroscience literature of pain so far. So we put this into a giant regression model, we get a signature pattern, which is a set of weights. And those weights are weights that we can apply to any brain image that we want to put into it, to feed in, calculate a weighted average, and out comes a single number. That's the best way to pain. So this pattern in a training sample, we called it the neurologic pain signature because the editors of the journal required that we call it that. We didn't want to get the paper rejected, so we said, okay, I don't love it, but it's nice to have a name because you know what you're testing across studies. So this pattern involves activity in the dorsal anterior cingulate cortex, anterior mid insula, medial ventral hypothalamus, posterior insula S2. Those are all areas that receive nociceptive information from the periphery, either monosynaptically, one synapse, or really relatively directly. They're all known to be involved in creating that pain experience in other studies. They've all been studied in animal models. So the main point here is that that's really a sensible map. And some of the machine learning based brain maps that you see in the literature are crazy maps. They don't make any sense. So it's really important to have maps that really make neurophysiological sense. And then the other point is that it's not just that I have activity somewhere in the cingulate or somewhere in the insula, because as Tavi said, those brain structures overall respond to many things. What we have instead is a precisely specified pattern of activity in precise locations and relative activity. So it's more here than down there. So this is pain on, this is pain off, this is pain off, this is... So it's a more complex pattern than you could describe easily verbally. And that's really important. So then we can apply that signature to new test data. We take a new sample of data, we take an individual from that sample, and we apply it, the signature of those brain images. So for every condition we're testing, we feed in the data and we get a single response value, which is the predicted pain intensity. And this is an example of applying that to a new sample from a new study. So each of these lines is one individual, 46, 47, 48 degree heat. And then we can compare high versus low, and each person has a high versus low dot here. And now if we're going to make a decision, if we're going to compare, here's two conditions, and now we happen to know here one of them's high, one of them's low, and we're going to make a guess, which one's more painful? We'd get it right here in 96% of this sample. And that's the ballpark accuracy level that we've been achieving with this kind of test, with limited data. It gets more accurate as you get more data, and there are other tests that you could do that are also more complicated, but that's kind of a benchmark. So we've been testing that in a number of studies in our lab, and we've also been collecting data sets throughout the world and sharing those data sets with collaborators back and forth to test this particular marker. And what that lets us do is say, okay, we have this thing, this brain measure. It's called a pain signature, but let's find out what it's really measuring by validating the construct that it's measuring, by testing its responses across many different conditions, multiple types of pain, things that are not pain. So I'll give you a snapshot of what that looks like so far. And it's activated, this particular pattern is activated by many things that are indeed somatic evoked pain. And and this is, in every one of these cases, for stimulus versus control, we hit about the 90% mark. Or above. So this responds to heat, shock, pressure, gastric and esophageal distension, rectal distension if it's painful, vaginal pressure if it's painful, and to a few other things like breathlessness, feeling like you can't breathe, aversive taste to some degree, but it doesn't scale with the stimulus intensity. So there's some, there's a little bit of ambiguity there, but by and large, that responds to multiple types of somatic pain. It doesn't respond to multiple things that are otherwise confusable for pain. Things that are negative, arousing, salient, like looking at aversive images that are disturbing or disgusting or horrifying, being rejected socially, looking at other people in pain, pain anticipation, and all of these things have been claimed in the published literature to activate the same areas as pain. And they activate the same broad areas, but they don't activate this finely tuned pattern, this machine learning derived pattern. Nausea, itch, thinking, cognitive demand, recalling pain, and non-painful warmth, so somatic stimulation that's not painful. So if we look forward to the next years, I think we'll see the development of predictive models in many ways, in pain and beyond pain. So this is a growing trend in the literature. I really think it's something that's going to take off. And what we've done is we've just finished a review of about 500 studies in the literature that use this same kind of approach, feeding in whole brain images and saying, what can we tell about a patient in the clinical domain? And you can see here that the papers cover many different areas of clinical and translational medicine. Alzheimer's, psychosis and schizophrenia, depression, autism, ADHD, Parkinson's. There's just a little sliver of pain and PTSD and mood disorders. So those things are coming. And through this survey, we learned a few things. I'll share a couple of take-home points with you. One is that there's really cause for hope, but there's also cause for concern, as you might imagine. So the hopeful case is if you look at each of these different cases here, these different disease categories, in every case, you have something where this is predictive accuracy here, where you have accuracy for discriminating who's got the disorder versus who's a control that approaches 100%. And this, each of these circles here is a study, and the size of the circle is the sample size. And the larger circles are studies with now over 1,000 people in them. So they're growing in size as well. So you see lots of potentially optimistic cases here. But I don't think we're also there yet. And here's why. So what we tried to do in the approach I just showed you with our pain signature is develop a pattern and test it without changing it at all across different studies, in different contexts, in different populations, different people around the world. And so we can get a good sense of how that thing is performing if I really applied it prospectively to new people. But that's not what most of these studies have done. So far, even though these studies sometimes have 1,000 people, they usually develop a marker on that sample, and then they publish that, and they never validate it in an independent sample. So they have what my old colleague Walter Michel liked to call the toothbrush problem. Nobody wants to use anybody else's. So you have 500 studies and 500 different models of depression and anxiety, and nobody's actually testing other people's models for the most part. You can take a guess for yourself at what percentage of those 500 studies actually did a replication on a new sample to validate how accurate their marker was. And I'll give you the answer, it's 9%. So very few of those studies so far. This is going to change, because people like me are going around saying this stuff. So if you look at the accuracy in those studies, you'll notice that many of those categories are missing, including pain. And you'll notice that it's really only accurate probably for Alzheimer's disease. There's reasonable evidence. All these other domains, there's really, the accuracy levels are much lower. There's really not a lot of evidence yet for very accurate markers. Okay, so that's, I think, where we're headed, towards really rigorous replication of these models. So far, we have a good measure for evoked pain. I think that can be used in some cases to understand components of clinical pain, like allodynia, when touch becomes painful, or hypersensitivity to evoked pain. But it isn't a measure for clinical ongoing pain, and so far, there are no studies in the literature which present brain markers for ongoing clinical pain that have been independently replicated in another laboratory. I'm going to turn back now to another issue that's been really important for pain measurement, So I showed you how easy it is to manipulate pain reports by changing people's expectations about pain. So what about placebo effects? If you get a fake drug, and this has been a real problem for clinical trials, and it's an interesting philosophical issue for understanding patients too. So if patients report pain relief during a clinical trial, what does that really mean? Does that mean that the drug worked and they're going to show a long-term therapeutic gain? Or did they just think they were getting better right now and they're feeling better, but nothing has changed about their biology? And so there's not going to be likely a long-term improvement, right? So we don't know, just because people report feeling better in a clinical trial, we don't know that the drug or device or whatever it was actually affected the intended mechanism. And that's where brain imaging can help. We don't know if it's disease modifying, which might have legal implications as well. I don't know. So I'll just give you one example of a placebo, problematic placebo effect. So this is a gene therapy trial for Parkinson's disease. It's AAV neurotrinin, which is a dopaminergic agent. So it's widely believed and known that dopamine is involved in Parkinson's disease, and there's a loss of dopamine in the ventral striatum, or in the striatum. So in this treatment, they injected a viral vector that promotes dopamine increases in the striatum. This had worked in high-profile papers in monkeys, and so now they moved it to clinical trials in humans. So the good news is, if you look at Parkinson's symptoms, this is an aggregate improvement, symptom improvement score. People got better and they stayed better for 2 years after the treatment. So it's great news. But the problem is, this trial failed. Why did it fail? Because people in the sham or placebo surgery condition got better at the same rate and stayed better for 2 years. And this prompted this drug company to be sold off for parts. In pain, there's a similar problem, and several other disorders as well. So in pain, the placebo responses have been getting larger, this is pain relief going down here, across years. But they haven't been getting larger for drug, and the drug conditions. So the placebo versus drug difference is shrinking across the years. More and more trials are failing because of large placebo response rates. There's many, we can speculate, we can maybe in the discussion if you'd like to, about why this might be happening. I think it's complex. But I'll leave it for a discussion if you're interested. So now we can come back to the idea of placebo. Now, we've been studying placebo effects for 15 years in the lab, and so have all these other people who agreed to share data with us in a collaborative study to test our pain signature on placebo conditions across studies. So we got a sample of 20 different studies from people around the world. They've all got conditions where there's a control condition where people get no drug, and there's a placebo condition where people get a fake drug. And so there's a placebo control difference in every person. And these are all pain studies as well. So we can validate that this our pain signature works for pain, if it does, and we can also look at the effects of placebo. So what you see here is that placebo, in each of these studies, the leftward shift indicates that placebo significantly reduced pain in all of these studies. So that's great. The effect size is moderate. It's exactly what we expect. Now we can look at our pain signature response, and now we see the rightward shift indicates that there's an increase across all these 600 people in responses with pain, right, in our pain signature. So that validates the pain signature. What you see here is each line is a study, each dot is an individual person. So nearly all of the individual participants in this sample showed the effect in the right direction. The effect size is very large, if you like those things, and there's samples of multiple different kinds of pain here. So that's a validation that the signature is doing what it's supposed to be doing. So now we can test what happens with the placebo treatment. And the answer is, there's very little effect. There's a tiny statistically significant reduction here in the whole group, but you see there's really almost no effect across the entire sample. And the effect size here is tiny. So it's insensitive to placebo. Now that points to contributions from other systems that we can discover, unpack, and explore. But it means that this particular measure is tracking nociceptive pain, but it's pretty insensitive to what you believe is happening. So that can help us establish efficacy. If you think about this from a clinical trials perspective, we can look at these intermediate outcomes in the brain that are sensitive to pain but not placebo, and may or may not be impacted by particular drugs. Okay, so I'd like to reiterate that none of these brain measures measures pain itself. They measure neurophysiological systems that contribute to pain. So here's one system that I've been describing. It's this classic nociceptive pain system with a pattern of brain activity that captures that. But now I'll just turn briefly to another system that's involved in pain avoidance. And this is the medial prefrontal accumbens system. And if you turn to what do we know about what about chronic ongoing pain, and a lot of these studies have been done by Bonnie Apkarian's group in Northwestern on back pain in particular, so we have a lot more to learn about other pain conditions. But the idea is that if you look at what happens early on, right, what you see is a lot of nociceptive targets, cingulate, insula, thalamus, so some of the same areas that we've been discussing here, right? But what happens a year later is in the people who have transitioned to chronic pain, then the brain activity that tracks pain has shifted to the ventral medial prefrontal cortex and nucleus accumbens and other sorts of value and motivational mediators. Some of these are really not nociceptive areas. You can turn up heat on people's arms or give them painful experiences. It's not going to increase activity in this circuit. So it's doing something else. In the people who, for whom the back pain resolves, you don't see that kind of effect. So what they like to say is there's a shift in the correlates of pain from classic pain-related systems to those systems that are involved in, they use the word emotion here. I like value and motivation. So in this study of theirs, they find that connectivity in this frontostriatal value-related circuit or motivational circuit predicts the transition to chronic back pain a year later. And interestingly, there's also evidence in animals that this really matters for pain behavior. So in this study from Jing Wang's group at NYU, they used a chronic pain model that elicits a high level of chronic pain. So this is what you see here, withdrawal threshold. And then what they did is they stimulated the prefrontal cortex optogenetically with light, activating a circuit from the prefrontal cortex to the nucleus accumbens. So this precise pathway here. And when they did that, they completely eliminated the pain behavior. And they also eliminated signs of depression-like behavior associated with pain. So these circuits can really matter. So in lots of work that we've been doing over the years, you know, we think that this is a circuit for learned avoidance. It's not about what's coming up from your back exactly. It's about taking what's come up from your back or your knee or your neck into the brain and saying, how bad is this? How much should I avoid doing things that are associated with that pain? Should I disengage? And that's a huge problem for pain patients. So it's a different process, I think. So this is a circuit for learned avoidance. It's also, if you think about drug correlates of drug craving in the brain, this is a meta-analysis we're doing now. It is the strongest correlate of drug craving. So this might be a key to pain avoidance and then increased desire to use various drugs to ameliorate that. And it's also a circuit that's susceptible to cognitive interventions. So far in our studies, you cannot rethink your neurologic pain signature. That circuit, like placebo effects, you can't turn it up and down by rethinking it or trying to change it mentally. But you can change this circuit, which might have profound effects for behavior. So the idea then, if we'd like to stratify patients, we can say, okay, let's take this one pathway, the pathology is peripheral spinal, we have this one brain measure, NPS measure, and then this is a treatment option, that a treatment that's focused on the periphery, focused on finding out what's happening in your back is probably a good idea. But if you have a different kind of pathology, if it's in the brain itself, in the frontostriatal systems, we have different potential measures that are still being developed, and then we have a different treatment pathway. So a better treatment option is probably not to dig around in your back and potentially cause much more harm as well as cost, but to think about biobehavioral treatments, cognitive therapies, and other drugs that work in different ways, if you like drugs. Okay, so that's a bit about patient stratification. So I've just got a couple minutes, if that's still okay. And I'm just gonna go back to the patient perspective with a case study. This is a 65-year-old male. He strained his back while loading a suitcase onto an airport conveyor belt. The pain kept going. 2 weeks later, he's got spasms. They suspected a disc herniation, but all of his MRIs were normal, multiple areas. He's got physical therapy, acupuncture, massage, other things for 5 months, nothing works. The pain migrates from one part, one side to the other. So now he's losing strength in his hamstring, he's got pain radiating, they suspect a nerve entrapment, but all the injections of steroids, anesthetics, local blocks, ineffective. So nobody can figure it out. So he says, as time went on, my symptoms and limitations worsened, various clinicians offered suggestions, some wondered whether the pain was becoming functional, he began showing signs of depression, and so on. And the interesting thing about this, so you can ask yourself, you know, if you were a physician, what would you do? Would you do surgery on the back? Would you do psychotherapy? What would you do? And the interesting thing about this case is that it's actually, this is the patient. Philip Pitso, who's the former dean of Stanford Medical School, and he was actually also the chair of the 2011 Institute of Medicine Committee on Relieving Pain in America. So he wrote, and this description comes from his New England Journal of Medicine editorial, where he says, I thought I understood pain until I actually got it, right? And so if this were any of us, or many of us, we might still be untreated, because he had a number of connections and other tests that were finally done. They did discover something peripheral. He's got a piriformis syndrome. They were able to fix it. He's better now. But many of us, that would never happen. So we wouldn't even know where to look. And so these biomarkers for pain can have multiple kinds of implications, right? We can use them for multiple outcomes, as well as pain reports. We can use them to understand cognitive impairment, fear and avoidance, other kinds of outcomes. We can use them to evaluate multiple kinds of treatments and predictors on a level playing field. So these are all different kinds of predictors that people are really interested in. These are different kinds of therapies that all work in various ways, but we don't understand yet how they really work at the brain circuit level. So we can help to understand that. And the last bit, going back to court, so I'll give you one more case study. So this is Carl Koch, I'm not sure how to say his name right, but his arm was burned by molten asphalt in a work-related injury, and he sued for damages. And Joy Hirsch was contracted to do a scan of his brain, and this is that scan. So you can see the activity here doing a squeeze ball task. And she argued, you know, that brushing on the affected body site and squeezing the ball produced activity that was consistent with the claims of pain. And this is, of course, not, this is based on just a read. It's a subjective read of this pattern, this activity. It's not published. There's no published link between what she was doing and pain. But she said, we don't need to publish this because sensory mapping is already validated, past Albert and Fry, is usable in court, et cetera. So it's validated. And Sean Mackey testified for the opposition and said, well, this could be related to imagined pain or emotion or something else. And Joy said, signs of imagined pain are not present in this scan. So therefore, you know, it must be pain. And that was a pretty clever maneuver, if you ask me, because if Mackey says, no, here's signs of imagined pain, he's sort of playing the same game. He reads the tea leaves and says, oh yeah, there's the imagined pain, and there's this, and there's that. So it's interesting. So this was actually settled out of court. So the testimony wasn't admitted, and then they settled without testimony. So just the threat of brain imaging was important here. And so, as Tavi mentioned, a group of us just wrote a paper, partly in response to this kind of thing, about where we're at. And I'm not really sure it's a consensus that we all really fully agree, but nonetheless, my favorite part of that paper is to try to establish criteria for what would you actually need to be able to argue something in court or to be able to use something clinically. And some of those, there's a number of criteria that we laid out, which I think are sensible. I think the bar is very high. But the criteria are, in short, that we need precisely defined signatures. You can't look at a brain map and say, oh, here's some activity, and let's just interpret that map. That's not going to work. We need these precisely defined patterns like I showed you. We need them to be replicated and applied without adjustment across laboratories, pain variants, and populations. We need them to be sensitive and specific to pain. at a minimum before we can start even thinking about being able to bring those into court. So I think we've taken some steps toward that, and I think we have some additional steps that we still need to take. And I think that the judgment of when any of these brain measures is ready for use in court is up to lawyers and judges and people who are going to be the decision makers there. And people like me can provide evidence on what we think is going to be valid scientific evidence that something really is sensitive and specific and a valid measure. So with that, I'll say thank you to my funding sources over the past years, and thank you very much for your attention.